Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Be Better on Purpose, the Passion for Purpose Up Close and Personal podcast. I have the professor, William Dillard, the minister of music. I knew him from Mount Nebo Baptist Church and Life Center, but now he's getting ready to do greater things. And some of y'all probably know him from some other things, be it the Gospel Music Workshop of America or some other type of great choir event. I present Professor William Dillard, and they want to know, who is William Dillard? So, why don't you tell us, who are you?
Thank you so much, Dr. Jones, for inviting me. I just really look forward to this experience. Again, we go way, way back, and we had some great times at Mount Nebo, and I'm just glad that we're able to hook up again, you know, in 2023.
Yeah.
It's been almost 32 years ago, but I am William C. Dillard. I am retired from Mount Nebo Baptist Church and Life Center. I've been in the music ministry for 46 years.
Wow.
I was a minister of music of Mount Nebo for 32 and a half years, really almost 33 years. And so I look forward to just fellowshipping.
And you know, when I tell you, I've been thinking about this for such a while, and I said, you know, I don't think you realize the impact you had on me as a person in faith, in the choir, and my beginning of ministry.
Oh my God, my God. You know, sometimes you just don't realize, you know, I begin to reflect. I'm a reflective thinker. Mm-hmm. And I've heard people like you, Dr. Jones, say, you know, you've had an impact on my life. And I say, well, what did I really do? You know, I just enjoy what I do. And I don't really think about the impact, but I am just so, so grateful of people like you, Dr. Jones, who would say you had an impact on my life. You know, I hear it a lot of times in the school system from students and from other teachers, but just to hear it from the music ministry is just, I mean, it's just warming.
You know, it's amazing to me. I think about some of the things that you said. You had a quote years and years ago, and I'm not even sure if you use it anymore, but I use it often. And this quote is, a sad dog is a dog that won't wag his own tail.
Yes, right. I still use it. Right, you got to wag your own tail. That's a sad dog, right?
Yeah.
And you know what? I use that quote, but I really don't utilize the quote. Because I don't wag my own tail. I like wagging other people's tail. It sounds kind of funny, but you know, because I like to give other people their props. I like to push other people. I like to push singers. I like to push choirs. I like to push musicians. So that's what I do. I don't really, you know, because I was at a church not too long ago, this past Sunday, and the pastor just went up and said, we have a legend in our building, and you done so much. And I said, oh my God, you know, I said, I must be really somebody. But yeah. I just, you know, it's not that I'm ungrateful. I'm just humble at that. My mother taught me to be humble.
And what it does, it gives confidence to people. So, you know, it was funny, I was telling my wife, and she said, well, you're excited about this, aren't you? I said, yeah, this is a little different. This is really personal for me and everything. And I said, you know, I think we was like early 30s when we first met. Early 30s or late 20s or something.
Yeah, you in RA choir.
Yeah, you in RA choir. And I said, throughout the years, so much has happened, but I've always kept my eyes, because I still have family at Mount Nebo.
Okay. They
have friends at Mount Nebo, and it's like I just always kept my heart and my ear on Mount Nebo and everything.
Yeah.
See some of the great things you've done throughout the years, and there are so many people that we know indirectly. Like I see you talk to people, share with people on social media, and I said, man, he just knows everybody, because I know these people too. Especially those who came out of the Cobb County school system.
Yeah.
We just know so many people in common. And I said, boy, it's going to be a great time. I was thinking about when I was in the choir, I've always been more of a complimentary type of person. You know, I could harmonize, I guess, but I would get the butterflies in my stomach. I don't even remember the song now, but you had me bleeding the song. I said, but this man don't fell and bumped his head on something. Got me trying to lead a song.
Hey, you made it through the song. I can't remember the song right now, but I do remember you leading the song, but you made it through. And we made it through. So that's amazing.
Boy, I said, and you know what that was doing? Said what it ended up doing for me was giving me confidence in being in front of a lot of people in a church setting. Cause my background, I was okay with speaking and like banking and things like that, things I was doing. I said, you know, church people kind of, they can get kind of funny with you.
Oh, yes, yes.
On a Sunday morning.
And back during that time at Mount Nebo, because Mount Nebo, even though we weren't, we were considered a semi-mega church.
Yes.
So that, you know, so back during that time, we were a mega church. So, yeah, I can see, I didn't really ever get butterflies. I wanted to be sure that the music was right. I wanted the music to be right at 8 o'clock and 11 o'clock. That's why we rehearsed so much, you know, even on Tuesday and Thursdays to 10 and 11 o'clock and 12 or whatever it was until I was satisfied.
You know, I still have flashbacks of some of the Tuesdays and Thursdays rehearsals and things like that. I said, you know, it just embedded such a unique love of music ministry in doing so. And you know, though you grow up in a church and you sing in choirs, but it takes certain people to bring out the best in people that they don't even know exist within them. And that's one of the things I could really say I've seen you do throughout time with so many different people, and not just at Mount Nebo, but at other churches and other events throughout the city and in the Cobb County school system where you're working. So how did you end up leaving Darryl and coming to Atlanta?
Well, to be honest with you, one of my friends, Glenn Ficklin, moved here. And matter of fact, he was a member of my choir, in my college choir, and in Natchitoches, Louisiana. So he moved to Atlanta. He said, well, why don't you move to Atlanta? And my mother had just died when I was about 14, when I was 14. Mm-hmm. So my family's kind of split. And so a lot of my family members were moving to Houston and to California. But I stayed with my sister. When I'm saying my sister Vera, I'm calling her my sister and my mother because she raised me.
Yeah.
And so I stayed there. And then after going, I went to Southern a semester and got put out of Southern. They put me out of Southern because I didn't have the money. It wasn't because of my grades. Mm-hmm. And so I left Southern and went to Northwestern State University. And that's where I met. And I met Glenn. I met the Natchitoches into the Nominational Choir. I started playing for the choir there. I started playing for churches there. And then all of a sudden, you know, I just started playing for everybody, everybody's program and all of that. And so then in Natchitoches, that's where I met a lot of my friends. So Glenn said, won't you move to Atlanta? I said, no, I can't move to Atlanta. What am I going to do in Atlanta? And then I thought about it. It was time. I had a community choir that I dearly loved in Darryl. I had over 180 young people, and we would travel from city to city, from state to state. We would travel every weekend on school buses. And we got to work with, I mean, some great people. Jackie Smith out of Houston. We got to appear on programs. You probably don't remember. Do you remember Yolanda Adams when she was 16 in Southeast Inspirational Choir?
Let me tell you, I had a crush on Yolanda Adams when she was 16 because we were the same age.
Okay,
and I hearing her sing, what was the first, not My Liberty, it was before My Liberty, Think on These Things.
Yeah.
I was so amazed by Yolanda Adams being age and having a voice like that. I think it was Southeast Inspirational Choir.
It was Southeast Inspirational Choir.
Yeah, I remember her.
It was Southeast Inspirational Choir, and it was formed by Shirley Joyner. Brenda, I can't think of her name right now, but Brenda and Carl Preacher. So it was a group called BC&S.
Okay.
And with BC&S, they end up forming the choir. Mm-hmm. And because I live, my little hometown is so close to Houston, so I was going back and forth to Houston. When I tell you my community choir, we were going to Houston and Beaumont almost every other weekend. And I can even remember we did a concert at Reverend Paul Jones Church.
Hmm.
That's the guy, I won't complain.
I remember about Reverend Paul Jones.
So I had a community choir there. And then they were teenagers, so they began to, you know, leave and go to college. And it kind of went down from maybe 100. I know we had 180 at one time, maybe down to 100. Then they start going to school. And I said, you know what, it's time for me to do something different.
Yeah.
And I said, well, I'll try Atlanta. This is funny. I'll try Atlanta for 1 year. And if it didn't work, you know, I just moved back to Darryl, I moved to Houston, I moved to California, and I've been here ever since.
That's amazing. You know, because I'm just thinking about when you came here and everything, and when I first heard you, I said, man, this guy sounds like James Cleveland, Reverend James Cleveland. And I said, we got a minute Reverend James Cleveland up here.
Well, to be honest with you, even back in my hometown in DeRidder, they used to call me James Cleveland.
Wow, I can see it too.
Yeah, so yeah, everybody gave me that nickname, James Cleveland. And I really acknowledge him, you know, I admonish. It was a great, great experience in the 80s. I got a chance to go to L.A. My godmother took me to L.A. and I went to Cornerstone on Western and Slauson. That's where Cornerstone was. And I got a chance to play James Cleveland's White Baby Grand in Cornerstone. I got to meet him. We talked. And the one thing is, I said, Reverend Cleveland, I really, I love you. I love you. I love your music. I love what you're doing. He said, well, you coming to the workshop this year? I said, yes, sir, I'll be there. And that was my first workshop in Houston in the early 80s. Yeah.
You know, I would have loved to have met him because we had every album that he had out in his house. And when I was younger, my family would sing all the James Cleveland songs and the choir and everything. And I even tried to not imitate the singing, but I used to see how he used to tell people to hush and shh.
Oh, yeah. That was his trademark.
Yeah.
Saying, shh, 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 shh. And to be honest with you, Dr. Jones, I still have at least, because Jonathan came to my house to do a video, I have at least 40 or 50 of James Cleveland's albums.
Oh, wow.
I still have the albums in
That's
my
amazing. House. I have a few of them, but I end up building a library on my YouTube channel for him.
I still have the real albums.
Oh, wow. Now, the only album I think I have was the one with Southern California with God Is on it. The original.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
77, I think 76 or 77. And
yeah.
I guess I'm really dating myself talking about I have an album from back then.
Yeah, I didn't think you were that old. Yeah, because he has the process standing out and the choir is standing out. It's almost like they're standing in a forest or something of that nature. Yeah, I got that album too.
Oh, yeah. I'm of age. We're about the same age. We're close to age. One, say, right at each other. Probably about either a year of the same age.
So, okay. Yeah, you know. Don't tell your age.
I'm not going to tell it. But I like what people say. Look at how good they look on this video.
Yeah.
But, so, you know, I looked at the wellness journey that you've been doing recently too, and I want to make sure that we got that in here, because what you are doing is inspiring so many people to get out and start walking. And I said, man, when I stayed out of Stone Mountain, I hardly ever went to Stone Mountain, and now that I don't stay out there, I want to go, but I'm just in other places I can go. But I see you at Stone Mountain often, going around the mountain and doing your conditioning and working out. What is that like?
Well, to be honest with you, I don't know if you remember, I guess in the mid-90s, when I was real heavy, I got sick at church one Sunday. It was the second Sunday in November. I got sick, and I told Reverend Micah, I got to go home or go somewhere. And Lenars took me to the fire station on Boulder Crest.
Mm.
And I was just feeling dizzy. I was just feeling bad. And the guy came out. He said, you need to go to the hospital now.
Wow.
And so Lenars went, I told Lenars, he said, you got to promise me, I signed a document that I would go to the hospital. Lenars went back to the church. I had one of my good friends come, Glenn, to come pick me up, took me to the hospital. And I didn't know what was going on. And I was diagnosed with diabetes.
Okay. Wow.
And I said, oh my God. So, you know, during that time, you know, I was thinking about people who had diabetes, you know, either their legs got cut off, they went blind and all. I said, oh my God. And so I immediately began to change my eating habits because it took them a while to get my blood sugar level. I stayed in the hospital maybe about 5 or 6 hours. Then I went to my primary doctor. And then I had to, take 3 different medicines for diabetes. I had to prick my finger, and I was getting depressed. I said, I can't live like this.
Yeah.
I was on 12 pills. My diabetes was high, my high blood pressure was high, I had a whole lot going on. And I said, you know what? I just cannot. I will not live like this. Yeah. And my godmother, who raised me, Mama Blunt, who raised me, who really taught me how to play, she was a diabetic, and she would have to take the shots.
Wow.
I'm scared of needles.
Yeah.
I said, oh, I can't result to that. And so that's when I began to change my eating habits.
Yeah.
And I pretty much maintain. I've gained a little weight here and there, back and forth, but I still do my exercise. Yeah. I still go to the gym 4 or 5, maybe 6 times a week. I still go to Stone Mountain.
Yeah.
I still walk every day. So I'm really, my weakness is bread. So I got to go back and work on my bread.
Yeah.
I love bread, but I pretty much kind of maintain. And during the pandemic, and I've seen, you know, so many people, not so many, but a lot of people who, you know, just got kind of away from their regimen of, you know, working out or whatever. And they just kind of got big. I said, I can't do that. So I really kept my regimen, even during the pandemic. I would get up in the morning and walk before I go to school, or go online, you know.
Yeah.
So I pretty much kept that. Yeah.
And, you know, and it makes a difference in our lives, especially
say
when we start realizing, you know, our health is going to be around a lot longer than our wealth a lot of times, and our friends and family. And you only get one body.
Right.
I had a physical once, and they told me they said, you're pre-diabetic. I'm like, what?
Really?
Oh, yeah. They said pre, and this was some years ago. And I said, I'll tell you what, give me 6 months, because I refuse to take the pill. I'm going to take none of them. I said, give me 6 months. If I hadn't done nothing bad, I'll do what you tell me to do.
Yeah.
I started working out, started running, I started keto, and my wife started fixing me better meals and stuff.
Yeah.
Donuts and cookies.
Yeah.
And they still haunt me every night.
Yeah, they do. Me too.
Yeah, they haunt me and everything. And I said, if I'm going to do this, let me give me some apple cider vinegar and go and run or something.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I do. Because, you know, like you say, it still haunts me. You know, I'm not a big sweets eater. My weakness is bread. I love bread. I just love bread. But it's like you say, it still haunts me. I try not to eat as much bread. I try to change the kind of bread, you know, multigrain, not that it's that much healthier, but I try to, you know, really change the kind of bread that I eat. But I still try to keep up with my regimen of working out, you know.
And it makes a difference too. Once you start the routine, your body looks for it every day. Your body, it'll come searching, like giving signals. Hey, where my walk at?
Where my
weight at? You know, like that.
And I didn't go today because I had a full schedule. I know I had a collaborative plan at one of the schools that I worked with all day today. Then I had a faculty meeting for the class I teach at night. And of course, they're still in the meeting. And then I know I had this. And so I'm going to miss it. But 4:30 in the morning, I'm going to be at the gym.
And you know, that's the thing too, being consistent with that too.
Yeah.
I have a lot of equipment here at home. But when I go to the gym, I get motivated seeing other people do it.
Yeah.
If I could work out at home, I have everything I need here.
Yeah.
But going to the gym, I see, you know, you make friends and you start learning different things to work on your body with, and different nutrition type foods to eat and everything.
Yeah.
And you know, I only pay like $25 a month. What better use than $25 a month?
$25,
to your body,
you know? And see, I got really hooked into, you know, the running and I don't run as fast as I would like to.
Yeah.
I really run, I'm gonna use the word fast, one time, well, maybe 3 or 4 times a year. But I really do that during the Peachtree Road Race, because I'm not trying to beat anybody else. I'm trying to beat my previous results from the previous year.
Yeah.
So last year I was in the top, I think it was 30% for the people my age bracket.
Wow.
I was up at top, so I got to beat what I did last year. I did, it was 6.2 miles. I did 1 hour and 17 minutes.
Oh, wow. You're running.
So I did 1 hour and 17 minutes. So I got to beat that. But I had gotten down to 1 hour and 9 minutes one of those years. I've been doing it maybe Peachtree, maybe 14 years. I didn't do it during the pandemic.
Okay.
2 years I didn't do it. I didn't do it the pandemic year, and I didn't do it the year. You know how they had the virtual thing?
Yeah.
I didn't do it that year. But last year, I did go back. And so I was a little rusty. So I got to beat 1 hour and 17 minutes this year. That's my goal.
Oh, wow. I have never done the Peachtree. I keep saying I'm going to do it, but it's just something about getting up that early on the 4th of July. I want to do it, but it's just, I could just think of something.
You can do it.
I'd rather do it. Because I do 5K. I do 5K all the time. We got a 5K coming up, I think, next month. And then the HBCU 5K run.
Okay.
But my best 5K was, you know how they do the one for the mayor's race in Atlanta? They have the airport.
Yeah, so, the airport at night or something.
Early, it was like 5 in the morning. I went out there, and I think I did like a 31-minute 5K. I said, and I was sick that day. I had like sinus and allergies.
Yeah.
But my wife said it was that... say Clariton that had me running like that.
Said,
that was all me. That was no Clariton.
I need to do that because I don't know. I really, the first year I did the Peace Tree, it was kind of like a celebratory because I had lost all the weight. I had lost like 100 pounds the first year. And the funny thing is they wouldn't let me in because, you know, the lottery had closed.
Yeah.
And I sent an email to somebody, I don't know, the manager of the one of the Atlanta Track Club, and they let me in. So I've been going ever since. Yeah, I hate to miss it. You know, I really look forward to it every year. And it's the good thing about it is you see so many people, but it's not about, you know, so many people out there running and, you know, the star track people, but you see people out there who, I saw one guy, he was on crutches, but he made it across the line. Like that that's motivating. Yeah. It's really motivating.
And that's the thing about, you know, when you're around people doing things like that, it gives you the energy to keep going.
Yeah.
You know, what you're doing is not in vain. And some people do it, just like you said, you know, just to be out there. And some doing it because they've been doing it for so long in the name of a loved one who used to love to run.
I enjoyed it. I'm looking forward to it this year. I have not signed up. They said they're not going to have the lottery, but I'm going to sign up in the next month, in the next 2 weeks.
Okay, so have it come up yet?
It's up now.
Okay, I need to go and race. I think this might I might run it. So I might,
but do that.
I think I'm going to do that when we finish. I'm going to go to the site.
It's open right now. And they say they're not doing the lottery. They're just going to cap it off, I guess, after 60,000 people, whatever it is. Okay. So it's
open. I have to do it and get up real early in the morning. I think I probably have to catch Marta to go down there.
You do. I do. When I get up, about 4:35. And I live in Stone Mountain, so I catch the far east. I catch MARTA, and of course I don't do MARTA but one time a year, so I catch MARTA and then go down to Little Five Points and then catch it north and whatever it is, but you won't get lost. So
they start at Lenox, right?
It starts at Lenox Mall. Yes.
I really think I'm gonna do that this year because I just want to do it because I never did it. And once I started, I'll keep on doing it from then.
Of course, I want to do the what's the one in November? I want to eventually do the half marathon.
Yeah.
I want to do it at least one time. I've heard about that. I want to do that at least one time.
I think because I like collecting like the 13.2s and the different.
Yeah.
I think I might try just to be able to say I completed. You know, I might have the greatest time, but at least I completed.
You will.
Need to check it off and everything. Yeah. But you had mentioned earlier too about Lenaris and Jonathan. I want to talk about that too because you three. When I tell you, I don't know too many church musicians that have been together as consistently as you all are, and to be as efficient and effective, and you all are brothers, y'all love each other.
You can tell that's
more than music, because when y'all are together, it's like y'all just feel each other. Talk about that song.
I know we made some changes, and we thank God for changes because, you know, changes are needed, you know, changes are needed. But the three of us, I mean, like you said, Lenaris was there, you know, he was there before I came. But when Jonathan came, then Jonathan left and Jonathan came back and he stayed there. We have a bond. You know, I love the guys dearly and they love me and I know they do.
Yeah.
You know, we can feel each other, you know, in services, we can bond to be sure that the service is going like it needs to. And that's the difference. And I'm kind of going off on a tangent. That's the difference in some now these young musicians. Yeah. They don't realize the importance of ministry. Mm-hmm. And see, our goal was to be sure that we minister to the people. You know, Rev. Michael pushed that to us, pushed it on us. Be sure that you minister to the people, because whatever you do, it's about the people coming down. During that time, you know, we're doing virtual now, but during that time, people coming down the aisle. We have, you know, we traveled together, you know, when the choir would travel to different cities. And it's just like, you know, I guess I'm the big brother, or maybe daddy now, but I'm the oldest. But we've never had a fight. Now, we've had some disagreements, but before that rehearsal was over, we came back to an agreement, you know. And so, and one thing I can say about them, that they are very, very respectful.
Yeah.
You know, that's, you know, and you don't find musicians like that. And as you said, Linares is a very talented, I'm not going to use the word drummer, a talented percussionist.
Yes, he is.
Jonathan is a very talented maestro musician. And we would work together, you know, we would come to rehearsals early to iron out what we need to do to ensure that our rehearsals were what they need to be, to ensure what the service needed to be. We never had a problem. And I, you know, I don't know how that we began to bond like that, but, you know, and I was, to be honest with you, I was a little selfish, if I use that word, because I didn't want anybody else to play for me.
But yeah.
Jonathan.
I definitely understand that. And you know, just to see how y'all three grow together. I run into Linares quite often around town because he'll play for different people that I know. You know, like I have to go on and see a friend of mine's band play at some jazz spot. And Linares is over there on the drum. You know, just seeing him and John, and I go to another event, like a special event at a church, and I see Linares or Jonathan playing, backing the group up and stuff like that. And I think about all that talent that was at Mount Nebo and everything.
Yeah.
I have to say this while I have you on here. I praise God for Pastor AJ McMichael and the opportunity that he give people to come and utilize their skills and their talents and gifts and to help them grow it. You know, I said, sometimes I feel like I owe Mount Nebo an apology. And the reason I say that, when I first started preaching, I said, well, they heard some of these, like something, I can't even listen to some of those sermons now, even though I have them on audio tape. I said, boy, they sat through some of those sermons and encouraged me and hugged me and everything.
Yeah.
I can only imagine Pastor Mike sitting there, he gonna get it eventually. He'll get it eventually.
You are right. Mount Nebo is a very, very encouraging church, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and like you said, you know, we want our music. We have some flaws some Sundays. Mm-hmm. Now, I think we were sometimes good at covering up our flaws, you know. Yeah. But I knew it was, so I would go back and be sure that we cleaned up. But again, you know, Rev. McMichael, he saw something in me, you know, because coming from a little country town, you know, and I remember in meeting him, he said, well, can you play? I said, yes, I can play, you know. Mm-hmm. And then he said, well, can you teach? I said, now that, Rev, and I said, I promise you I can do that. And then with that being started, you know, I started teaching the choir. Then he's okay. But the thing about it, that what I liked about Rev. McMichael is that we did varied genres. And I say this, and even Kwame, as we talk about this now, we were able to go anywhere and hang with anybody. If it was just the anthems without the gospel and the clapping, you know, like ITC, you know, we didn't go over there, you know, jumping and turning and over there. And it was very, very, you know, very, very elite. Mm-hmm. We were able to function there. We were able to function if we had to go to a Church of God in Christ church. Mm-hmm. We were able to go to a Catholic church. We were able to function. And one thing that we tried to do is that every Sunday, we tried to meet our congregation. You know, maybe you like anthems. Maybe Deacon Harvey like hymns. Maybe Sister Harvey like traditional music.
Yeah.
Maybe Bianca and them, they like the Pam and they like the contemporary. And we tried to, in our menu, if I may say that, we tried to be sure that we met everybody's needs every Sunday. Most of the time, I think we did. There were some times that we didn't, and that's okay. We would go back and rectify. But we tried to be sure that we were just able to do everything. I remember teaching the Hallelujah course, And Rev. McMichael said, I always wanted my choir, my church choir, to sing the Hallelujah Chorus.
Yeah.
It took us 3 months to learn it.
Oh, but wow.
Once we learned it, mm-hmm. we had it, you know. And so we, you know, we did anthem, we did scores, we did hymns, and we did the traditional, we did the contemporary, we did, and you know me, you know, I would, whatever the top 10 was that I heard, I would come back and teach those that week. And I can say that the choir was vulnerable and they were willing to learn. You know, we stayed in rehearsal. We didn't think about that.
And you know, then what's so interesting about this too, my gospel, I tell people I'm stuck in the 80s and 90s for gospel music, because I would listen to the new stuff, but only when it comes on. But yeah, if I just pick my music, it's always something coming from the 80s and 90s and maybe early 2000s.
Yeah.
There's something about that era of music. It was just that, I guess that was the era when I was just really involved in it deeply like that, impressionable with it. But one thing I can say about the ministry, especially the music ministry of Mount Nebo and the ministry period, it kind of messed me up when I got out on my own, because I've been trying to find that for the longest, and I just realized that God just had something different for me. But I say, but at least he let me experience it for the years I had it, because I think about some of you all and some of the songs that you all were singing and how you all were ministering. And I know we all have a different walk and journey in ministry, and I'm very grateful for where I am and what I'm doing.
Right, but it's nothing
like when I tell people, I say, oh yeah, y'all sound good, but let me tell you about a choir that I sing with. Let me tell you about some of the sermons I heard at the church I came out of and things like that.
And
you know, it really prepared me. So when I went to a little country town for a while to pass before I came back to the city, when I went up to Liberty University to get my doctorate, I was well prepared because of what I got from all those people in the church that I came out of.
And I like what you said. You know, I know that, as we say, you know, things change, times change.
Yeah.
I know that it's not, but I still believe it's going to come back. I know it's not the era of the choir right now. You know, I know it's the movement of the praise teams and that, but I still feel that eventually the choir is coming back. I know that, and I've been told, I'm not a praise leader. I mean, that's not my calling to be a praise leader. I am a choir director. I am a choir minister of music.
Yeah.
I am a church minister of music, you know. So, and I know that, and you were talking about, you know, what is your purpose? I know that's what God has for me to do, because I've been doing it so well. No, not so well. I'm going to say that. Doing it so long, but God has granted me the privilege to do it that way. And I know that's my calling, you know. I know that I'm not called to do what Tasha Cobbs do. I mean, that's not my calling. But I know it's my calling to. And the thing about it is, Dr. Jones, I know that some of the choirs, a lot of choirs are auditions. So you say, who can? I've always been able to, and not to be braggadocious, to pull the common choir members and make them sound just as good and sometimes as better as some of the audition choirs.
I agree.
That's my calling. You know, I would love to. I know back during the time when we were talking about, you know, Mount Nebo Choir, one of my favorite choirs in the city during that time was Cathedral of Faith. Maurice Culpepper, Dr. Maurice Culpepper, the director, you know, I admired him. And the sound that they had, that I would go to Cathedral Faith on Sunday nights just to hear the choir. And I would come back and, you know, I would mount me. Okay, y'all gonna sing high just like Cathedral. That's what you're gonna do. You know, so go ahead and do what you need to do. That's what we gonna sound like. So, and again, even during that time, and I just appreciate even Maurice would come to some of our concerts. And so again, I would take the common choir, and I want them to be the best.
Yeah.
I was very serious about it. Very serious about it.
And you know, you just made me think about another one of your quotes that you used to share often too. If you can carry a bucket, you should carry a tune.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can. And it, you got all my quotes. I need to write them.
They were life to me. I still use those quotes.
No, I mean, you know, and I thank God for, you know, like you said, I thank God for Mount Nebo, because Rev. McMichael instilled something in us, but then people outside of Mount Nebo start coming and say, okay, this Mount Nebo, okay, yeah. You know, I remember one of the first workshops that I did, and nobody probably don't remember this. it was with Donnie McClurkin, and I got that gig, I'm gonna call it a gig, or that job, was because Wanlon Stokes said Dillard and Mount Nick, because she knew she was coming to our concert.
Yeah, I remember that.
You know, MC, and she, you know, she hooked me on to Donnie McClurkin, and because he came here for something, and I end up, you know, teaching a class. You know, John P. Key came to record, you know,
so. That.
And we even, you know, did concert with John P. Key, Timothy Wright, you know, Dorothy Norwood, Douglas Miller. So people started saying, okay, well, let's get Mount Nebo's choir. And so, again, because we were different, because we were able to do whatever it was, you know. And then going back to, you know, that Anchors in the Lord. And I say this as a joke. I remember when Lisa Ram came to us the first time, he brought in someone to teach Mount Nebo's choir the music.
Oh, wow.
She did. And so, you know, okay, the person came in and he played and he taught and I helped him teaching. The next time that person, we did it like four other times, that person never came back.
Oh, wow.
Because I get, she realized, okay, but Dillard can do this. Okay, well, you know. And
yeah.
So we kept going back and forth, you know, with that, with the Anchors in the Lord. So I really wish that, you know, I hope I can see this again. Maybe I won't. I really want to see the choir again. I want to see, you know, that we're able to do the varied genres. We're able to minister to, you know, people like we did before. And I think that some people saying, yeah, you know, Dillard, won't you just push that out? You know, so maybe that right now, that's kind of what I'm working on as my next.
I remember when y'all did, so it was one of the reunion concerts y'all did, the choir reunion. And telling D. Wallace, I said, you know, I felt so bad because she said, you were coming sing. I said, it was just, the timing just wasn't good for me. And I said, I hadn't sung in years. I said,
okay.
But you know, I was unable to make that, but I really was making effort. I said, I'm gonna see, can I do this? And it's just things
you
just
can do it.
Working nothing, but I really wanted to be a part of that. Cause I said, yeah. I remember this group of people. And even I just stand in the back and just sing, you know, I've just been willing to do something like that. But I just love the idea of a reunion choir like that, y'all did and what was going on with it.
And we're gonna do it again. I don't know under what circumstances.
Yeah,
we're kind of working on the next.
Mm-hmm.
So we're gonna do something like that again. And so then, again, we want you to come and sing.
Yeah, okay? And I'll come and I'll stand in the background and just smile and dirt.
We want you to come and sing.
Stuff like that. You know, I don't think people realize the importance of the foundation of Christianity through music, through worship and praise and all those old hymns that our forefathers and foremothers sung and taught us. You know, I go around the house sometimes singing songs and it's like, man, I didn't even know I remember the song, but it just, it come out of you sometimes.
Yeah, it's innate. It's innate. Yeah. I mean, it's instilled within you. You know, I even now, even some Sundays I listen a lot to 91.9 Rodney Evans, because a lot of times he played a lot of the choir songs, the old choir songs, and he played some songs last week. Like again, he played My Liberty, and I had not heard it, so I went to YouTube and played again because it was in my ear. He played My Liberty. He played, you know, just choir songs. So you know, and the choir is not dead. The choir is not dead. So we're gonna do some things.
Now I'm gonna say hope, maybe you might be able to answer this. I don't know. But you mentioned Rodney Evans and WCLK. He used to play a song years and years ago. It was his closing song. And I can't think of it. I could never think of the name of it. And it's like, now unto it's like a benediction song. But I can remember. I could never describe it. Nobody. And I could never describe it.
I'm going to find it and send it to you. I know he did today. I want to be closer is one time he did. Today I want to be closer. He rose with that, but then now the other one, now who is able to keep you from falling?
I didn't know who made it or anything.
Closer was Lamar Campbell.
I remember Lamar Campbell. Yeah,
and I don't know if you remember this. You know who's singing at Mount Nebo?
Closer.
I
didn't remember that.
Yeah, we sang at Mount Nebo. Okay. Guess who sang it? My girl, Karen Pitts.
Karen Pitts. Now, let me tell you, Karen Pitts, I listen to at least once a week. I still listen to He's Not Up by DFW Mass Choir.
Oh, yeah.
And when I tell you, I could just still see Karen singing that song. I still see us on that song. I listen to that about probably about once a week, because that's in my top rotation.
Okay, yeah. Karen was my right hand back then, you know, because she was the soloist. She, you know, she sang some, she started, you know, with you all, she was an alto. Yeah. And then I moved her to soprano, but she was still able to handle that. So, yeah, Karen was, she was my girl. She was my girl.
And she was a sweetheart. Let me tell you, she helped me so much because I became president of the GNR choir. And she had just said she was going out president.
Okay.
I said, I don't know what to do with this right here. She said, all they have to do is show up on time and be consistent. That was one of the things. On time and be consistent. And I did that. But yeah, she was a sweetheart.
She was.
Tyrone, I remember and everything. Such great things. And that was like the core of the foundation of who I am in ministry now, because a lot of what I do, I draw from what I know. All you can do. The Holy Spirit would draw from what's already in you.
So, right.
How'd that happen?
And you all were a good group of people. I remember, you know, because you all had the, I don't know if you remember, when I first came, we got the Burgundy Rose was the Sanctuary Choir, and the GNRA had the Black and White Rose.
I remember the Black and White Rose. Yeah. I still have an old picture with the black and white robe on when I had braces on my teeth.
those were good days.
And I think about all the different people that came through and everything. And when they got ready to do your retirement, I put that down on the calendar. I said, I'm going to this retirement. I had to leave early because I had a meeting. And I told them, I said, I might be late because I'm going to a retirement celebration. And just to be there to witness all the things that people was able to share with you throughout the years you had been in Mount Nebo and years you've been in music ministry and things like that, I thought it was a great thing for you to get your flowers while you could smell them and appreciate them.
Well, I really appreciate you coming, just seeing you there and seeing the people. I think at first they wanted to do the retirement go a different avenue. Mm-hmm. They wanted me to come in and you know, just sit and just, I said, no, I don't, that's not what I want to do. And I thank God for Pierre as well as the team members. And they said, well, Dillard said he don't want to do that. He said he want to do it this way. So we will let him do it this way. And because I wanted to give back. I wanted to, and I said this, and I really mean this. It wasn't, even though, and I thank God for the people honoring me and saying the good things that you all are saying about me. I didn't want it to go there. I wanted it to be not about me, but about the choir and about the ministry.
Yeah.
That was accomplished. So that's what I wanted to do. But I could have come in, just sit down and just, you know, and nod. No, I wanted to be about the choir, about the music ministry, and what we, like you said, what we had done in the past. I wanted to feature that, and that's what, and it, we accomplished that.
And when I tell you, it was just such a good thing. And then I got home later on and found out it was on YouTube. I was able to look at the full thing on YouTube and everything because when I came in, they kept trying to get me to come down to the front with Pastor Jones and Reverend Head and all them.
Okay, yeah, you should.
I said, I don't want to be disobedient by walking out in the middle and everybody see me. So I said, I'm going to sit kind of in the back so it won't be no disturbance or nothing like that. But I really wanted to get closer so I could feel it more.
Yeah.
You know, I said, that wasn't seem right, knowing I couldn't stay long and I had to leave and walk through the whole thing. I said, I couldn't do that. So that was our
thank you for coming. I mean, just your presence and just presence of people again like you and people I had not, and I've seen you because I do follow Champion. I follow you, you know.
Okay,
I don't say much, but I, you know, what as the children say, I stalk your
okay, good.
Yeah, I do Champion, so I do stalk your ministry. And again, just to see you there, that just really, really just blessed my heart.
You know, I couldn't even imagine not being that, knowing what all you have meant to me personally as well as a ministry of people that I love dearly and a group of people I love dearly. You know, every time I run to somebody from Mount Nebo, my heart just feels something. Like, y'all was a part of my foundation. Y'all part of me being who I am today. And I still feel the prayers from the people from Mount Nebo. I still feel the love from when I'm out and about.
Yeah.
I'm always have love for the people that came up on that ministry that Pastor Matt Michael put together, and just taught people how to live and love for the Lord and worship the Lord. So it's a great thing. So,
and it's a family. It's a family. You know, even in rehearsal, you know, we knew everybody. And I was thinking, you know, we even had families in families who sung together. You had the Paxtons with a family.
Yeah.
You had Bianca and her mom with a family. You had the Stinchcombs with a family. You had the Mims with a family. Yeah. And I'm probably missing some of this, but you had just families, you know,
the Thelma family. Bernice,
the family. So it was a lot of family thing. And it was really a family church, and it was a family choir. It was
a whole lot of talent in these families too.
Yeah, exactly.
I said, how do some of these families get this much talent in it? I can't even borrow talent like that. It was just great. So before we leave, I want to ask you to share with people who may be able to see this video about the importance of knowing what's in your heart, because that's where purpose starts, in our heart. And sometimes we are able to find it, and sometimes other people could find it and show it to you and help you get there. So there might be somebody listening who's struggling with what they want to do in life, or why did God put them in the place they're in and stuff like that. And, you know, we can just really, we can find our purpose in the most obscure way.
Yeah.
And if you just listen and open your heart, it can come. So I like to try to get people to come on and say, just share something that when you knew that this is what it is, this is it, the light bulb went off, and how it felt and how that passion just ignited. Because passion is like gas in the car. It will drive you to your purpose.
Yes, it will. I'm glad you put those two together. Yeah. You know, I remember the Rick Warren Purpose Driven Life.
Yeah, I
knew that my purpose from a child, I knew that my purpose was to be in music ministry. Mm-hmm. And I knew that the Lord was going to grant me that. I used to pray to the Lord and say, Lord, I just want to play. And I remember, you know, like I said, I mentioned Mama Blunt, because she would sit with me and work with me on the piano. She could read, but she didn't have the to it. Yeah. And I had the but I couldn't read it, but she would work with me. And I want to say that, you know, there's a book that I do with my teachers in my school. Mm-hmm. You're here for a reason.
Okay.
And so it is in divine order that we are going through this podcast tonight. Yeah. It is divine order that for me to retire from Mount Nebo when I did, it is not that I've given up music ministry. It is not. Yeah. I knew from a child what I wanted to do. And the Lord has granted me that privilege. You know, it's a privilege to be a music minister. It's a privilege to, it is an honor to honor God through music. And I knew that that was my purpose. So I'm saying to us, you know, we know what our purpose is. If you don't know, just trust God. God will guide you. He won't leave you. You know, I know the plans. I know the plans that I have for you. You know, it's not for you to be harmed. It is for you to prosper, and it's to have hope for the future. So I'm saying to us and to whoever listens to this, you are here for a reason. You have a purpose. And the ingredient and the recipe is that you have to trust God. You have to work on your purpose. You don't say that I have a purpose to do something and don't work toward it.
Yes.
So you have to trust God. You have to work your purpose, and your purpose will work for you.
That's it. That sounds like something I have in one of my books right there. Have you read one of my books? Because this show sounds like I can't have one of my books.
Me too.
But that was amazing. And I don't have nothing to add to that. Not one tittle, not one jot, not one nothing. That was amazing. And I just thank God for you, Professor Dillard. I thank God for all that you have done for so many people in the body of Christ, and all that you still have left in the tank to continue to do as you go forward. Because eyes haven't seen, nor ears heard,
yes, but not heard.
To the hearts of men and women who love the Lord, what God has prepared for them. And it's just so much more that God has prepared for you. And I just look forward to seeing what God's going to do with your life and what you're going to do to help.
And same thing, and Pastor Jones and Dr. Jones, I want to say that I really, really appreciate you even thinking that much of me to even invite me to be a part of this podcast. I was a little nervous. I said, I don't know what I'm going to say. And one of my friends said, oh, you know how to talk. Don't worry about that. You know how to talk. You have to say.
Yeah.
But again, thank you so much for thinking that much of me to even invite me. I've seen some of your podcasts, you know, like I said, on Facebook and all.
Yeah.
But I really thank you for, you know, again, I'm I didn't know I had that kind of impact on your life.
Oh, you did.
But now that I've done it, and I thank God, and to God be the glory that I did, and I just thank you so much for even thinking that much of little old me to invite me to be a part of
it. I was so excited. I said, he have no idea how excited. I told my wife, I said, boy, this is going to be good just being able to talk to him, because I said, we hadn't just had good conversations since back, I think I left about like 95 or something.
Yeah.
I miss just being in your presence, hearing you talk and teach and communicate and share stuff. I said, this is going to be good.
I hope that it was.
It was.
Okay, all right. Well, thank you so much.
So thank you. So be better on purpose. You've heard it here from Professor William Dillard, my good friend, my brother in Christ, all the way from Darryl, Louisiana. And then we didn't even talk about the album that you had out that I purchased years and years ago. When I was in Louisiana. I still have the album in my stack.
Thank you.
But Be Better on Purpose, we have it here, Professor William Dillard. And I just thank God for him. And you would not want to miss this podcast. So we are better on purpose. Until we're together again, peace.